Okay, so I think that now is working. Okay, so this the first slide is it is a nice picture of the installation in Torino. So you can see on the back the two module of solid oxide fuel cell produced by Convion from Finland, installed in the wastewater treatment plant. The Demosol project is a project financed by European Commission, by FCAJU. It is a partnership between five partners, it's a small consortium. Politecnico di Torino is the coordinator. I am the principal coordinator of the project. There is Convion, which is the company in Finland that supply the technology of the solid oxide fuel cell. There is the end user, which is the SMAT group in Torino that hosts the demonstrator in the wastewater treatment plant. There is VTT, the research center in Finland that works with us for the analysis of the operation of the plant. And Imperial College from London that makes especially the analysis from the point of view of the business and the economy. So in this context, today, as I said, we will focus on the problem of the contaminant contained in the biogas. So the outline of the presentation will be the interest of connecting high temperature fuel cell in the biogas sector. It is probably one of the most interesting early market and for several reasons, also because the biogas is a renewable fuel. And so this is a good opportunity, but with some problem that we will discuss in this series of webinars. Today we will deal especially on the Demosoft cleaning system, so the design, starting from the analysis of the selection of the carbons for the absorption of the contaminant, the important issue about the gas analyzer. So Qualvista will make a focus on this during the presentation. Qualvista is the company that has produced the gas analyzer, the analysis of the results. And then we will move to the optimization of the layout that we have produced, which is basically a layout for a demonstration project. So it can be improved, of course, in future application. Then we will move to the economics of the cleaning system to see some aspect about the cost. And on this aspect, optimization and economics, there will be a contribution from the producer, the company that has produced the cleaning system, which is Biocomp. And finally, we will conclude with the lesson learned, so the conclusion and the future work that we are doing because we are working on some other project about this issue, which will analyze also other type of biogas sources, not only the wastewater treatment plant biogas. So the interest of using fuel cell in biogas is, of course, everybody knows the high electrical efficiency, which is the characteristic of this type of machine. So we have ops everybody knows, but we have experienced directly in the plant an electrical efficiency in the range between 50 and 60%, depending on the point of operation. So very high electrical conversion efficiency. The other aspect, which is very considered, especially for the local administration, the local municipalities, is the very low emission or zero emission for some type of contaminant, so nitrogen oxide, sulfur oxide, particulate matter, and volatile organic compounds are basically zero. Also, considering the measurement that we have done on the chimney of the plant, so these are very good points. And also, it is a good combination to have a fuel cell in a wastewater treatment plant because the wastewater treatment plant needs some heat also, not only electricity, but also heat for the operation of the digester. So the solid oxide produced also as a byproduct heat. So there is a good valorization of this heat in the plant, and it has a good economic effect on the global economic management of the plant. So this HP configuration is an advantage. The negative aspect, of course, are still the high cost. So this is, of course, a big topic that will be analyzed in one of the webinars that we will give, which is the fourth webinar on economics. So if you are interested to know more, you can follow this type of webinar. And the other aspect that we will treat today is the need for a deep cleaning of the biogas. because the anode, the state of the art material in the anode of the fuel cell suffer the contaminant that are contained in the biogas. Of course, the aspect of the type and quantity of the biogas contaminants depends strongly on the typology of the starting biomass, so the merceology, I can say, and also on the treatment that is done on the sorry. Sorry, just a second, because you can see normally.
Yes, we can see your screen.
Okay, which slide?
The second one.
Okay, so that's there is a problem on the just a second. Okay, I was here, sorry. The system has some strange effect. And so depend on the starting merceology and of course on the treatment performed on the line of production of biogas. For example, it's possible, like it is done in Torino, to use some additive like iron chloride in the water line in order to, and which has a secondary effect, partial separation of the sulfur. So there are some aspects to be considered. In terms of merceology, everybody knows the possibility of merceology for what concern the biogas are several. So there are aspects that are related to biogas can come from residual from residential sector, from the industrial sector, and from agriculture. There are several possibilities. I will not spend time on this, but I can say that the main characteristics are that basically, the wastewater, the biogas coming from wastewater, has a content of biogas which is quite clean, a typology of biogas which is quite clean. So the amount of hydrogen sulfur will be not that much, and the siloxane also will be not that much. We will see the analysis. So the content of contaminant in this type of biogas is quite positive, we can say. And this is the one that we will discuss mostly in our presentation today. But there are other typologies of biogas, of course. For example, the biogas from landfill. Of course, the situation is different. There are very high level of different contaminants, especially different sulfur compounds, so mercaptan, thiols, siloxane again, and halogens. And the one coming from biogas coming from agriculture. The main characteristic is that the level of H2S is higher, definitely higher, significantly higher compared to the one from wastewater. So, of course, this will affect the necessity of cleanup and the type of process for the cleanup. In our case, we have dealt with wastewater biogas. The quantity we will see are not so high, so we have concentrated the typology of the cleaning system on adsorption processes. So without scrubbing before the adsorption, which was not necessary with this relatively low level of sulfur. So some aspect, the contaminant for biogas using fuel cell, the threshold are very low. So for example, in Demosov, we have a threshold given by the supplier, which is very, very strict. So you can see for sulfur, we have 30 ppb, and for siloxane, 10 ppb. So it is basically very, very low level. They are very conservative. We can say from other experience that we have done in other projects before and in the lab level, we have seen that from considering state of the art type of anode, so nickel based, let's say, probably the possibility to sustain sulfur is at around 1 ppm. This is confirmed from studies in literature, from experience in the lab, and from a paper that we have produced on this topic. Anyway, we have worked in order to respect the information, the target given by the supplier. At the same time, of course, the producer are working to increase the tolerance of the anode to the contaminant, not only the anode, also the reformer that usually is used in this type of system, the reformer. The work is also done at the level of material, of course. So considering to change the anode material to be more tolerant to contaminant, for example, working on a pure ceramic anode, like using perovskite material. Still is an activity which is in the research phase. We consider in our discussion the state of the art type of anode, so nickel based, which are the most considered now for a real system. This is the diagram, the schematic diagram of the cleaning system that we have developed with Biocomp. So some aspects are already present in the plant. So you can see at the beginning there is after the anaerobic digester there is a gas holder, and then there is a gravel filter to separate some of the water. Of course, the water is better if it is separated because it is in some way a competitor of adsorption processes in the bed of carbons, so it's better if it is separated. This is already existing. The second step is the plant that we have done. The initial part is basically related to the separation of water, because you see it is a site dependent. The digester, the gas holder was quite far from the plant, the site of installation of the solid oxide and the cleaning system, more than 100 meters of pipeline, so it was necessary to separate further the water with a chiller. This is site dependent, we will discuss later. And this is the picture of the chiller. Then we have the plant for the cleanup. So you see, it's basically, I can say since the beginning, it's very redundant in the sense that it has been oversized. We decided to do this because the target of this project was mostly to demonstrate the good operation of the solid oxide fuel cell in this industrial application. So we decided to save as much as possible to be sure from the point of view of the contaminant. But anyway, we have done a very good experience, and also we know how to reduce this redundancy following the experience of the project. Anyway, it is a you see a lead and lag configuration. So there are the first two cylinder for which represent the lead with activated carbon selective for silicon and so siloxane and for sulfur. Then there is the lag with again the same type of carbons. In between there are several sample points for the analysis of the gas, and we will discuss it later. And finally, there is as you see a sort of scavenger to be totally sure about the cleanup, and at the end a compressor and the final chiller to supply the fuel cell. Here you can see a picture of the skid of the cleaning system produced by Biocomp, and inside you can see the picture inside with the cylinder containing the carbons. So the design of the cleaning system, of course, has been based on the historical composition of the biogas, including the contaminant. But of course, the contaminants were the most important to consider. Then we have done the selection of the sorbents to be used in the cleanup cylinders. This is we have done by an experimental assessment done in the laboratory in Politecnico. And finally, the mechanical design have been done by Biocomp in collaboration with Politecnico, but Biocomp has produced the design and then produced the system. So we will start from the analysis of the biogas. As I said, this type of biogas is quite clean, so we have been lucky from this point of view. So you see the trend along 1 year of the sulfur and the silicon. So basically, the sulfur compound in this biogas is totally H2S. And the quantity, you see, the average value is around 26 milligram per cubic meter, which is equivalent to around 19 ppm of H2S. Concerning the silicon, in the case of the silicon, we have several siloxane, but mostly the more abundant is the D5, so a cyclic one. And the average quantity is 5.4 milligram per cubic meter, which is around 1 ppm. So these are the starting value that we have to clean to reach the target value of indicated by the producer of the solid oxide fuel cell. So starting from this value, we have considered to start the lab test in the Polytechnic Laboratory to select the adsorber. we have done mostly the test for H2S in Politecnico and about the siloxane in the Edmund Meckler Institute, still in Italy, which collaborate with us on this type of aspect. Today we will deal especially with the H2S, not particularly the siloxane. Anyway, we have produced several papers on the topic that, of course, we can signal to you if you are interested to have more information compared to the webinar of today. So the target is sulfur, basically, today. And we will start from the selection of the sorbent. We have selected some sorbent, several, but we list here the more important that we have considered. So the first is a sulfate trap R8G from US. It is a very very good sorbent, especially good for a low level of sulfur, but good also for siloxane. It is very flexible in the sense that it operates quite well in different conditions of operation, so different humidity, different content of oxygen, and so it's, I can say, very robust. But you see the cost is very high. Is around 15, 16 euro per kilogram, so the cost is impacting. It has the characteristic to have metals inside, especially some iron and mostly some copper, and this gives very good effect in terms of chemisorption we have observed. Then we have considered three Italian free adsorber for from an Italian producer, which is called Airdep. The CKC is impregnated with potassium bicarbonate. It is apparently good for sulfur removal and with a cost which is relatively low, 2.8 euro per kilogram. Of course, it has to be considered. The second one is the CKI, is activated by potassium iodide at 2%, which is a little more costly. 5 euro per kilogram. And finally, the C64, which is very good for siloxane removal. And we will see, finally selected this one. And the cost is relatively good, 2.2 euro per kilogram. Just some picture about the cartridge that we have used for the test in the lab. We have respected the aspect ratio. So the ratio between the diameter of the cartridge and the diameter of the pellet that are included inside the bed in order not to create a channeling effect. So it is better that it is higher than 10. It is a aspect ratio. We have worked at value which are basically higher than 10. And basically in this cartridge, we have reproduced the same aspect ratio of the real vessel in the real plant. The other test in this picture in the center have been done with, so in the cartridge, we have sieved the powders. In this other cylinder, you see we have used the pellets as they are. Of course, we have injected in the sample mixture of representing the biogas, so CH4 and CO2, additivated with sulfur, H2S. Then we have done the analysis using a mass spectrometer. We have evaluated essentially what is called the breakthrough time. We have considered the breakthrough time very conservatively when the contaminant started to slip across the adsorption bed. So we have been very conservative, I can say. But this has been considered considering the target, which are very strict from the solid oxide fuel cell producer. So some result in dry condition with only a mixture of CH4 and CO2, so without water and without humidity and without oxygen. You see some result obtained in this with this parameter. So the concentration of H2S at 20 ppm, the flow rate, the composition, the sample diameter, the gas hourly space velocity, the spatial velocity and the ratio between length and the diameter of the bed. You can read by yourself in the recorded session. We don't have much time to go in detail, but you see that the breakthrough time is definitely better for one of the three carbon considered, especially the one from Sulfatrap, the R8G. So you can see the absorption capacity is around 40 milligram per gram of carbon, milligram of sulfur per gram of carbon. Compared to the other two, CKC and CKI, the results are definitely better. So all the sorbent were a consideration which is important that, as you see from the number, all the sorbent were performing worse compared to the data sheet from the producer of the carbon. The best sorbent, as we can see, is by far the R8G. Of course, this type of tests are not sufficient because we considered to analyze other parameters in order to reach the condition which are more similar to the one that we have in the real Demosoft site. So the parameters that we have considered are two. In this slide, we will see more than two. In this slide, we will see the effect of the gas spatial velocity. So we have tested with the carbon CKC. So you see two tests at different spatial velocity. Of course, the effect of reducing the velocity in the bed is very impacting on the absorption capacity. So you see an increment of close to 100% reducing the velocity from 0.9 meter per second to 0.15 meter per second. And considering that the Demosoft velocity in the real plant is definitely lower at 0.04 meter per second. So of course, as we see, the spatial velocity is inversely proportional to the sorbent performance. The lab test has been done at higher velocity for a practical reason of duration of the test. So the performance are underestimated. So are conservative, let's say. In the real situation will be better because the velocity will be even lower. Then we have tested the effect of the length of the bed compared to the diameter. Again, you see the absorption effect increasing the ratio L over D. There is a good effect on the absorption capacity. You see an increase of 40%. Anyway, the selection in the Demosoft site has been not so high in terms of this ratio. This because in the Demosoft vessel, some dedicated solution has been considered by Biocomp inside the vessel to improve even better the absorption capacity that will be described by Biocomp later. Then finally, the highest influence, you can see the big effect of oxygen. So the presence of oxygen in the biogas affects a lot the capability of absorption of this carbon, especially you can see the CKC. And the CKC has a huge increase of the absorption capacity. You can see it's enormous, the increase, the improvement. And this is basically because this impregnation they make a activate a positive effect of chemical absorption using in presence of oxygen. So the presence of oxygen, even very low, we have done the test at 0.1% of oxygen, but even we have done also a lower content of oxygen, and the effect of improvement of the absorption was really huge. Here we have a description, a quantification of the amount of oxygen historically in the biogas in the site of SMAT. So you can see maybe there is not always 0.1%, it is lower, can be 0.05%, but as I said, 0.1% is not necessary because the amount of sulfur in this biogas is so low that even at lower quantity of oxygen, the effect of chemisorption is improved significantly. So you see that considering this effect of oxygen and the presence of oxygen in the biogas sector, in the biogas flow, and considering the economics of the cost of this bed, of these carbon beds, at the end, we have considered to make this decision. So, due to the high increase of performance and the lower cost of CKC sorbent, we have chosen this for the H2S removal. Then C64 has been not discussed today, but you can see our paper has been chosen for the siloxane because of very good performances even in dry condition, so with low humidity. The system has been sized by our decision in order to have a 12-month operation, so to have a maintenance in the plant of once a year. So we have done the design of the mechanical design with Biocomp considering this target. And finally, we have considered to design the system for water removal, so the chiller, in order to work in the optimal humidity range. You see it's quite large, from 45% to 85% of relative humidity, suggested by the supplier of the sorbents, but we have to add that we have not installed the humidity sensor, in the plant to reduce the cost. So we don't have really a control, a measurement, let's say, of this aspect, but we are confident that the humidity level is quite respected. So to conclude this aspect of the selection, we have only, just to say, obtained the Langmuir isotherm for the carbon CKC. So this is the isotherm. You can see that the operation in the SMAT site is not in the concentration that is not, I mean, the optimal one in order to make the best exploitation of this type of carbon. You see we are in this point, so around 20 ppm is in the in the initial part of the curve. Anyway, this is an aspect that we have considered that sufficient for our type of application in the plant. So this first part is concluded. Now I leave the microphone to Giua from Qualvista, and you can take the microphone.
Very good, thank you. Can somebody confirm that you can hear me?
Yes, very well.
Very good, very good. Thank you for this opportunity. I will try to be quick because we have a lot of material to cover today. A few words about the Qualvista biogas monitoring system that has been in use in this research project at the site at the Colenia plant. What Qualvista provides is a system that on a continuous basis measures and reports the composition of the biogas. Our core is in the ability and skill to measure siloxanes accurately, continuously, but on top of siloxanes, we also measure other gases that are relevant in projects like this, and especially in all industrial applications. In addition to siloxanes, we measure CH4, CO2, H2S, limonene optionally, and oxygen. And the point here is that we do a continuous measurement, so you get the results almost in real time, which is a crucial factor for a project like this and the industry. You know the composition of the biogas right now because it's measured right now. You know what it was half an hour ago. You know what it was yesterday. And because you have historical data, you will be able to predict also which way you're going. So a big improvement compared to traditional methods of taking measurements and samples just every now and then. Our purpose of producing this kind of system is, of course, for biogas and biomethane users to get an on-time understanding of the process and the quality and the composition of the biogas, how it can be used, how it can be traded, how it can be delivered and transferred, because I'm sure a lot of the audience here today are aware of the new standardization that has been set by the European Union. Just to name one, the EN 16723, which defines the maximum limit for certain contaminants in biogas and biomethane used in traffic use and in grid use. But of course, in CHP use and in, for example, solid oxide fuel cell use, as we are discussing today, it is crucial to know at all times the composition of the biogas. A few more words about specifications. This system is an industrial system, so it can be installed at the plant. It's fairly resistant to weather and temperature changes. You need a slight shelter at least to cover it, but not much more. You get the data on your PC, laptop, mobile device, whatever, in numerical values or as nice graphs, and that is usually the way that our customers use the data. They look at the trends and the graphs, and then they know the status of the biogas and the process. We are able to measure very low concentrations of these biogas components, especially the siloxanes. So it's a unique combination of accuracy, durability in the field, and continuous measurement. You get a new measurement every 10 to 40 minutes, depending on the configurations. I don't have time to go into the details right now, but it depends on how often you take the samples and the composition of that. I was asked to give an understanding of what the pricing is. Typically, we lease the system. It can also be purchased, so that you own the system. But typically, we lease the system at approximately 2,000 euros per month or less. I'm being safe on this side, so probably not more than 2,000. Again, depending a little bit on the use and the configuration. I don't want to use much more of your time today, but if we have time towards the end of the session, I'm happy to answer questions. And please feel free to contact Qualvista after this presentation as well, and send me email, and I will be happy to talk to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Juha. Juha, thank you so much, and congratulations for the technology we use with a good satisfaction and good result. So I give the microphone to Marta that will continue the discussion.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we do.
Okay, thank you. Okay, can you go to the next slide? Hello everyone, I'm Marta Candiglio from Politecnico di Torino. I will try to quickly go through the results from the cleaning unit. So for what concerning both raw and clean biogas composition and the performance compared to what we measure in the lab, and then something on the economics. So if we go to the next slide, just to remember, this is the layout of the cleaning system. We design different points of sampling that we also use for specific biogas analysis, but the Qualvista analyzer is continuously monitoring these three sampling points. So before the vessels, between the first two lead reactors and the second two leg reactors, so in the middle, and then after the four reactors. So we are continuously monitoring these three, and I will show you results on this. The system is monitoring the raw gas, so the B4 point, only once per day, in order not to send too dirty composition to the analyzer, and so to reduce the accuracy of the clean measurement. So we measure the B4 once per day, and after this measurement, we send the nitrogen to clean the analyzer, while the rest of the day is an alternately monitoring of middle and after sampling points. So every 40 minutes, we have a measurement of middle and after. If we go to the next slide, this is the overall contaminants levels in the gas during the different operating periods. As you see, we have around 640 days of measurement, since every point is once per day. But they were taken during different operating periods because the system was not operating continuously during these years, not because only because of the cleaning system, because of the SFC and other things, which you will see in the next webinars. But just to tell you that you will see continuous point, but actually they are referred to different operating periods. This is the level of HOS, which is measured in ppm, and the silicon is measured in as total silicon in milligram of silicon per cubic meter. So we don't have the information on the single siloxanes, but we have the information on the total silicon. And if we look in the next slide in detail to the single contaminants, this is HOS. In terms of ppm, the average value is around 26 ppm, which is in line with what we detected before the beginning of the project. It was 18 ppm. Maximum detected value was around 70 ppm. So it's anyway a relatively clean biogas in the whole world of biogas is available. The oscillation that you see, we don't have, unfortunately, a numerical coloration, but especially when we saw in some periods, you see around day 80 and day 370, HOS was very close to zero. We try to analyze the reason for this, and we discovered that this is strongly and directly related to the use of iron chloride in the water line. SMAT is dosing iron chloride to remove phosphorus in the water line because they have the control of on phosphate in clean water. But this is as a by effect, lateral effect, this is precipitating also sulfur. And in this period where the HOS was close to zero, the iron chloride dosing was increased by the plant operator. We are now trying, even if we have not many data available from the plant side, to generate a correlation, because it's interesting to see in terms of also of cost, which is the optimal ratio between dosing of iron chloride, which is a cost on a sense, and the reduction of the HOS level at the inlet of the cleaning system. So this is something which are analyzing more, because we have detected it was a really strong link between the HOS level and the iron chloride dosing. For what concerning other contaminants, if you go to the next slide, we can start from the bottom. We have the silicon content. Siloxanes are usually containing biogas because they come from the wastewater in terms of detergents, shampoos. So they come from these liquids containing the wastewater. Average value was around 3.5 milligrams of silicon per cubic meter. This was slightly lower than what we detected in the past, but we are again lower than 1 ppm equivalent of D5. And maximum values, very rare values, were around 9 milligrams of silicon per cubic meter. The oscillation in terms of silicon at the inlet are lower respect to sulfur. And again, we had never issues or peaks in this analysis. For what concerning methane, you can see that this gas is very rich in methane. We are always, usually always higher than 60%, except some rare points. Average value is 64%, so quite high. Anyway, we have seen that oscillation in methane are always well managed by the SFC system, so it's not an issue if the methane increases or decreases. And also by the cleaning system, in the experimental activities, we did analyze the effect of methane on the performance of the sorbent, but it was almost negligible compared to other parameters. So methane is sometimes oscillating during this period that you can see. We also had a maintenance, SMAT did a maintenance on the digester, so they use another digester for a certain period, but still methane was all quite constant and anyway well managed by the system, even if it was varying. If we go to the next slide, for what concerning clean side, so this was about raw gas. We have, of course, you see more measurements because analysis is done every 40 minutes. And what we detect is that the analysis from the Qualvista, this is the example of sulfur, were always below the detection limit of the instrument. So by today, we have never reached breakthrough of the first reactors. The clean gas was always clean, let's say, so we were below the detection limit of the instrument. We did also four gas analysis by an external lab to confirm this trend in 2017 and 2018. And all these gas analysis detected sulfur and silicon below the detection limit of the method used. For silicon, we also did, since there is not a standard method for measuring siloxanes in biogas, we did both thermal desorption and chemical desorption method for the analysis, and they were both confirming the non-present, let's say, of contaminant at the outlet. And we also confirm with the external lab analysis that the main contaminants in terms of sulfur was HOS. We almost never detected other sulfur compounds. And concerning the raw gas analysis, we have also a paper under preparation. I hope it will be published soon with other labs that came to site to compare the different analysis techniques. So the Qualvista analyzer and external lab and other techniques to verify also the reliability of our system. If we go to the next one, what we did finally also on the system is to analyze which was the currently sulfur and silicon loaded in the sorbents just for one vessel, the first two vessels, since we had no breakthrough, and compare this with the expected performance that we measured in the lab. So the current absorption capacity with the sulfur loaded is 27 milligrams of sulfur per gram of sorbent. What we measured in the lab was around 80 for the CKC. So we are, if we look at the percentages, at 32% of the theoretical maximum capacity that we should have on site. Well, so for silicon is even better. The performance in terms of siloxanes removal were very high. So we are just at 1.66% of the potential theoretical performance of the sorbent. The reason for this is, of course, as I showed you before, the system didn't work for the 3 years continuously, let's say, 2 years and a half continuously. We have a capacity factor of around 60%, 65. So we had a reduced number of hours of operation respect to what we design. And especially, this is the most affecting parameter, we always had one or two modules working respect to the design, which was a three SFC module working. This means a reduced biogas flow rate. And this is the reason why we never reach breakthrough by now, because we worked in a kind of off-design condition with reduced flow rate. And so we are still far from the breakthrough. This is what it seems from the comparison. If we then look in general to what we see in terms of cleaning system, we work a little bit to understand what could be done better in a replication of the demos of plant. And what we can do is, in terms of number of vessels, as you have seen, we have a lot of vessels. We have six vessels with between 250 and 300 kilograms each of sorbent. Our idea is that we could work with two vessels dedicated to silicon and sulfur, plus one safety scavenger vessel. And also, the lead and lag configuration, which is very important if you want to never stop the system, because you can switch, replace the sorbents while the system is working. We decided that it could be maybe removed, because it is suitable to think of a one stop per year of the system. So if the sorbents are designed in a way that can last for 1 year, we could have the stop for the maintenance and so remove all the valves. There are many two-way valves in the system which are increasing the cost. And also, as you've seen, we have a containerized solution, which is impacting a lot in terms of cost, investment cost, but also in terms of operating cost, because having gas in a closed environment means to have a lot of ventilation, and so both the investment cost and the electricity consumption are a lot affected. So one other optimization could be to have it in a covered area without any container. And the last thing is that many parts of the system are site dependent. So in this specific site of Collegno, the system was installed far, as we said before, far from the digester and the gas holder. So we need to have a blower and a chiller, but this is not happening in every site, or maybe there are sites where some parts are already existing. So some costs are site dependent, and also the compressor is a specification of the supplier. So these things should not be considered in all possible replication of this concept. If we go to the next one, we have just done some consideration, final consideration on economics. The first one is on the investment. The total capex of the current solution is slightly more than 1,000 euro for each kilowatt electric produced by the SOFC, where the highest share, you can see 70% of the cost, is related to the container part. And if we analyze we have done applying the optimization, which I showed you in the previous slide, we have seen that there can be a reduction between 40 and 50% of the cost. If you click this, okay. And so we could go to around 500-600 euro per kilowatt of investment cost, which is in line with the short-term cost given by one important workshop that was given in the US on gas cleaning for fuel cell. So we should work to optimize the system, but we are not so far, let's say, from the target value, at least for this kind of biogas. And if you go to the next one, we also analyze operating cost. Operating cost includes mainly three items. One is the maintenance of the mechanical parts, so chillers, blower, and compressor, which costs are in the range that you see on the right. Currently, in the plant, we did the first maintenance on the compressor, and we are close to do the second one. Then there is the sorbent replacement, so we need to replace the sorbents. If we consider to replace two vessels once per year with an average price of the sorbents of €4 per kilogram, this can vary a lot. The cost will be around €2,400 per year. Plus, and this is not negligible, there is the disposal cost. This is something on which we are working at lab level. These kind of sorbents are currently not regenerated and are disposed, and this is not optimal, we know. So we should work to go for regeneration or for biomaterial which can be not disposed, let's say, in landfill. And finally, we have electricity cost because the unit is consuming some power. Currently, a lot of power, not because of the compressor itself, but because of the entire unit with the price. So currently, the operating cost of the system is 1.5 euro cents per kilowatt hour, which we think is quite high in terms of impacting on the cost of the kilowatt hour produced. Always from the same report, in fact, the target costs were mentioned to be 1 euro cents in short term and less than 0.5 euro cents in target terms. So we should work also on this. This is something which we should work both in reducing the electrical consumption and also the mechanical parts as much as possible. I think now it's the turn to give the microphone to Biocomp. They have one slide with some evaluation they did also on the economics.
Yes, thanks, Marta. Can you hear
okay,
me?
We can hear you. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. It's Matteo Sostizzo and Paolo Guerra from Biocomp here. We are a company specialized in biogas compressor and treatments. Not just biogas, but the focus here today is biogas. So as already said both by Professor Santarelli and Marta Gambiglio, when we talk about biogas project, it is also a matter of site. It is always site depending, strongly site depending, not just because the gas composition, every biogas is different from another, but also for several other aspects. Here in this project, for instance, we have several meters from the digester, so we need pre-dehumidification at low pressure. We usually dehumidificate biogas at higher pressure because when you pressurize the biogas, the dew point changes, so it is more convenient to dehumidificate after the compression, but we have to avoid in this case condensate and freezing issues in the pipeline. So this is an extra cost which is depending on this side. This is just an example. Another example is the gas composition related to the final application. So we decided to divide the maintenance cost of our units in two parts, a kind of standard application maintenance cost, which is related to common application, which means micro turbines, engines, upgrading system, such kind of application, and special extra filtration that in this case is a very low level of contaminant request because the final application is a fuel cell, or maybe it could be the sulfurization system when the biogas content of sulfur is extremely high. Until we have to handle up to few hundreds of ppm of H2S, it's usually not necessary to handle sulfur for a standard application. It's not the case of fuel cell, of course. So If you see table BK1, BK means biocompact one, we have four different size of units in terms of flow rate of biogas treated. And please remember that costs are reported cost of maintenance of these units are strongly depending from the every single project. This is not even an average, it's just an indication because every project is different from another. If you handle natural gas, we can give more precise numbers, but in biogas, as I said, it's very variable. So we can see maintenance cost per cubic meter of biogas treated in table BK1. We are in this project, we are referring more or less in line to B75, which is a size of our model of compressor and basic treatment unit, which means pre-filtration, dehumidification, post-filtration of biogas for regular applications such as micro turbines. In table BK2, you have the same numbers referred to not to the every cubic meter of biogas treated, but every kilowatt hour electricity produced. Of course, you have to consider different types of technologies, from small micro turbines, which have an efficiency, electrical efficiency around 25%, to the great advantage of a fuel cell, which is the efficiency even higher than 50%. So the same cost reported in table BK1 are recalculated in BK2 in terms of cost per kilowatt hour of electricity produced. Let's go for the extra filtration. In this case, we have to reach a very, very low level of contaminants, so the filtration is the, as I said, in carbons for H2S and siloxane. We have an estimation of the already said costs from Marta, but actually we have to check after when they will be actually saturated, and we have to see when how much they will last in the real life of the system. This is an estimation, and we suppose that we can reduce a lot of this kind of costs, because the system is oversized, so we have variable costs to be reduced, and also fixed costs. That means every single transportation and activated carbon analysis for disposal, safety cost for every activity of disposal of old and used carbons can be reduced. So I think that's it. I hope it's pretty clear. Act on different variables to reduce this cost and reach the target cost that Marta said before.
Okay, we can go, I think, to the conclusion quite fast because we are running late. Just to sum up a little bit what was our experiences by now on the biogas cleaning system in the Demosol projects, we experienced a lot of cost increase because of ethics analysis or in general risk analysis, because we had biogas in a closed environment. And so this is something which we didn't consider a lot in the budget definition, but it's something that when working with biogas should be really taken into account, especially in an industrial environment, of course, so where experimental stuff are not valid anymore. Concerning the sorbents, we have done a lot of tests in the lab, and we have seen that usually or sometimes absorption capacity given by the producer are not tested in the condition which are at the site. Sometimes they are tested in air, sometimes in gas, but with a very high level of contaminants. So to have a reliable absorption capacity is really important, especially for fuel cell, which has a very low tolerance to contaminants. The engine can tolerate higher concentration, and so maybe you can accept that there is some breakthrough even before than what you expect. But with the fuel cell, having reliable numbers is very important to design a system which is cost effective also. The online gas analyzer is a useful tool because it let us make the replacement only when breakthrough really happens. So we think it's important to have it. On the other side, it's also important to look at the cost, and so to have it at a suitable cost for the entire system. For sulfur, there are many options for even, let's say, cheap electrochemical online sensor. For siloxanes, it's more difficult. And concerning the electrical consumption, we already said that it's very high currently, so we should work in reducing it. The compressor itself is not consuming anymore, so the issue is not really the 4-bar compressor, but is the entire system which should be reduced in terms of mechanical parts. And then in the startup phase, we had some issues related to freezing, which were experienced, but we were able to solve even some in the interface between control system. But in general, we can say that after this starting phase where we need to set up small things, the cleaning system in Demosol has been very robust. This is a general thought that we have on the system. And if we go ahead to conclude, we can go to the next one. The last thing is that we are also working in other projects. This is the waste to water project, which is ongoing. We are working on other biogases because we know that it's relatively easy, if we want to say, to clean gas from sewage, from wastewater. But the situation turns to be more difficult when we analyze agricultural biogas or municipal solid waste, organic fraction biogas, or landfill is the worst one. So we are working on other cleaning systems, not always based on sorbents, because sorbents are fine if you have a super small system or if you have a clean biogas. But we are working here on a cryogenic system, so to avoid chemical scrubbers for large systems. So this is, I don't want to go into details, but there are other things ongoing on the cleaning of biogas with the other partners, which are listed here. I think we can go to the question session.
Okay, thank you, Marta. It's Massimo again. We are late concerning there are so many things to say in the presentation, so we are late from this point of view, but of course we can consider to have a session of a question now. You can use the chat of the GoToMeeting, or you can use the microphone, and then of course you are free to make question to us whenever you want. Using I can give you the address in the chat, so you can use the email address, which is demosoft@polito.it. Okay, so said, if you want, you can, of course, make some question. Can the result of the demo somehow be extrapolated to a case in which the biogas is more contaminated? With the consequence of higher inlet concentration of H2S and silicon on the outer gas quality using the same gas cleaning system, the consequence of higher inlet concentration of the extrapolation is limited. In the sense that if we remain in the amount of concentration which is below 100 ppm for what remains for what concerns sulfur, we are quite confident that this type of result obtained with this carbon can be confirmed. We have also seen the Langmuir isotherm of the CKC, and the performance can be maintained also with higher amount of inlet concentration of sulfur. So for the sulfur, I can be quite confident with higher amount of biogas of sulfur in the biogas, let's say from 100 to even a little more, if I consider the Langmuir isotherm. For the siloxane, I think that we are we have still room in the sense that we are far from the saturation in terms of adsorption sites. So even for the siloxane, I think that we can go to higher level that can be around to 2 to 3 ppm, which are already a lot for a siloxane in a biogas. So I think that we can extrapolate this type of result with a quality of the biogas that will be can be even worse. If we go with content of sulfur higher than 200 ppm, I think is not not anymore robust to consider a cleaning system based only on adsorption. Probably we have to analyze other methodology like scrubbing or cryogenic. Is the work that we are now doing in the other project, which is called Waste to Watts. So this is what I can say observing the behavior of the isotherm of adsorption. I don't know, Marta, if you have some comments on this.
No, I generally agree in the sense that the sorbent's performance increase usually with the increase of the inlet concentration. The issue is that the duration then of the sorbents, because I agree that until some 100, then it depends also the size of the system, of course. Of ppm, we can think of a sorbents-based system, and we can extrapolate. We have models the performance and the duration of the system. When going to a higher concentration, very high concentration, sorbents-based only cleaning system are not suggested. Usually, they use bulk sulfur removal, and then they use sorbents for final cleaning. Yeah, you can use the microphone. You can activate.
Hello, here's Marcelino Cancela from NHPS. So I did the previous question. Just a follow-up question. What is the timeline for the new project regarding more contaminated biogas?
We have the project was supposed to end in December 2020. Actually, there will be an extension of around, I think, 1 year. There will be two demo sites, one small size farm system, and this will be based on sorbents because the idea is to have like a 10 kilowatt system, very small. The second one will be in agriculture. We have not, Biocom can comment if they want, but it should be in like a slaughterhouse industry. So with some both agricultural and slaughterhouse industry residuals. And these results from these should come, I can say, early next year, because the system are both under design and under construction, and they should move to the site and be tested. So I can imagine that they can go to the site early 2021 and then start producing results.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, there are some other questions. Of course, feel free, we can have also a couple of minutes. We want basically to maintain the schedule because everybody's very, busy. So, but yeah, if you have another question, of course, we can have now. Or as I said, you can write to the email address that I sent to you. So we can make any type of question about this first seminar. Okay, so if there are not other questions, I repeat, you can do it whenever you want using the email. I go to the last one. It's not moving because it's in pause. Sorry, just a second. It's not moving anymore, but anyway, just to remind you that I can do by voice that the next webinar will be given on the 3rd of June, and at the same time of today will be about the integration of the solid oxide fuel cell system in the biogas plant. Then we will be another webinar on the 10th of June, still in the same Wednesday and the same time, about the, is very interesting because it is about the performances of the SOFC module during the DemoSoft project, so you can see the result, more detail on the technical result. And finally, the last one, on the 17th of June, same day and same time, is again a Wednesday at 11, which I think is very interesting for people, which is related to the economics and market analysis of the SOFC technology. But of course, we will send you all the information and the remind about the next webinar. So thank you for attending this webinar, and I hope it has been interesting. And again, feel free to make any type of question to our email address. And I hope to meet you again in the next webinar that will be in 2 weeks from today. So thank you very much, and have a nice day.
Thank you very much. Thank you for this webinar.
Thank you.